Hello and welcome back to White Hot Glory, the place where you can come to learn how to be white hot for God's glory in these end days. Revelation 3:16 clearly says, Jesus says actually, that you are either hot or cold. There is no walking the fence in Christianity. There is no lukewarm in Christianity. We are called to love the Lord our God with all our hearts, minds, souls, and strength. And I believe that the church has grown lukewarm because, especially in today's cancel culture and people just getting offended at the slightest bit of anything, I don't think pastors are shepherding their flocks and correcting. And parents have almost given up correcting their kids. And so that's to the detriment of not just each person's soul, but it spreads. And when there's no correction in love, it leads others astray. And so this is something that I've recently encountered, and I wanted to tell you what happened so that you might learn, or you might grow, or you might come to be brave enough to gently rebuke and correct someone in biblical love. So here's what happened. My husband and I were our worship leaders, and we were watching a video of another worship leader who has tens of thousands of followers. And in this video, he's wearing the graphic of a very secular, very lost band. This band promotes pedophilia, drugs, promiscuity, depression, IV drug use, just things that Jesus died to deliver us from. And I was just thinking, if there was a kid watching this person, they're probably thinking, oh, that guy's a Christian, that guy listens to them, so they must be okay. Or, I've never heard of that band, I like this guy's music, so let me listen to that band. And I'm not saying that this graphic is an indication of somebody's salvation. We can never judge that as Christians. But I am saying that that graphic might be the difference between somebody who's looking at you and their salvation. Because you're either pointing people to God or you're not. The Bible clearly says that it's James 4:4. Let me get it for you exactly. It says, ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is an enemy of God. If we're loving the Lord our God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength, and we are a billboard, literally a billboard, for something that represents things against God, that's friends with the world, that is adultery, that is pointing people away from the Lord. And I mean, I would be doing that if I was wearing a skirt that was too short and causing a brother in Christ to stumble. I'm very mindful of what I wear at all times. And the only reason that I can see these things is because I used to listen to that kind of music. And the Lord has shown me very clearly that as a child of God who loves the Lord, my God, with all my heart, mind, soul, and strength, I don't have anything to do with those things anymore. And people have different convictions, but as a leader, as somebody that you knowingly have people watching you at all times, as somebody who's a representative of Christ, I should not be representing these things. And so I posted on a group on Facebook that, you know, it's for leaders in church. It said, "Hey guys, just a reminder to please be mindful of what you're wearing or how you're moving on stage or when recording, because people are watching. I just saw a video where this guy was singing to the Lord, but his shirt showed a graphic with heroin, mushrooms, a syringe, and a tiny little drawing of Satan in the middle of all of it. And no names, no pointing fingers, no nothing, just a reminder to please be mindful because we're supposed to be pointing people to the Lord." And I got just reamed because people are like, "Who are you to judge? Don't bash that ministry." And the Lord looks at the heart. And finally, the admin of the group shut the comments down for it and said, "You guys are arguing over a t-shirt. This is why we don't allow posts like this." And this is not about a t-shirt. This is about Christians, especially Christians in leadership, and what we represent, and not causing young people in Christ not to stumble. Matthew 18:6-7 says, "If anyone causes one of these little ones, those who believe in me, to stumble, it would be better for them to have a large millstone hung around their neck and to be drowned in the depths of the sea. Woe to the world because of the things that cause people to stumble. Such things must come, but woe to the person through whom they come." And this is a mistake that I easily could have made early on in my Christian walk. And by the grace of God, I prayed and asked God to make it so that I wouldn't be one who stumbles others. And I'm not perfect, but I try to be mindful at all times of who's watching, who's listening, whether it be the children that I have charge over, or people on the street that I'm just passing. And a lot of people were saying, it's just a picture. And so I just want to say that that's what Satan wants us to think. Satan, and I wore my scoffers gonna scoff t-shirt today because it's true. There are some people who will grasp the concept and the gravity of this video and be more mindful. And this is who I'm making this for people who want to be hot for God and not lukewarm and not in the world, but to be totally different because Jesus is coming soon. What are you going to be wearing when he comes? Are you going to be wearing something that says Satan? Are you going to be wearing something that says death? Are you going to be wearing something that glorifies heroin or magic mushrooms? If we took that graphic and we split it apart and just put type lettering in it, this is what that shirt would say. Does this belong on a platform? Does this belong on a child of God? Is this what we're supposed to be pointing people to as believers? This is the shirt. There's more to the shirt, actually, but it's broken down. And it broke my heart when the moderator of that group said, "You guys are arguing over a t-shirt. This is why we don't allow those posts." This is not about a t-shirt. This is about saying, this stuff is okay. As someone who believes in God, as someone who leads others, towards or away from the things of God. And I gotta take this stuff off because I just don't want this on me anymore. I used to have the exact t-shirts, and I thank God for opening my eyes, because I used to be so deep in sin and in that music scene and in drugs and thinking, oh, it's no big deal. I believe that's why the Lord has allowed me to have the wisdom that he, glory to God for opening my eyes and showing me what he has shown me. Proverbs 24:11-12 says, rescue those being led away to death. Hold back those staggering toward slaughter. If you say, but we knew nothing about this, does not he who weighs the hearts perceive it? Does not he who guards your life know it? Will he not repay everyone according to what they have done? And so now that you've watched this video, you know, you have been told. You're a billboard for Christ, or you're a billboard for Satan. There's no middle ground. There's no lukewarm. You're either for God or against him. You are either God loving or world loving. A lot of people are saying, don't judge. But if we as Christians cannot see and judge what sin is for ourselves because we have the word of God, we're lost. And I think elders and pastors need to talk about this kind of stuff with their congregation. I don't want to tell you what to wear, but I want to tell you what not to wear if it's pointing people to the wrong things. Now, Matthew 7 says, judge not lest ye be judged. However, you've got to take that chapter in context. Matthew 7 is about hypocritical judgment. Now, if I was an alcoholic and I was drinking every day, and I saw a brother or sister in Christ consume a glass of wine in the privacy of their own home, and I said, you shouldn't drink. Well, that's hypocrisy. That is having a giant plank in my eye while pointing out a speck in someone else's. That's what Matthew 7 is covering. That's what judge not lest ye be judged means. Matthew 8 is about man not being to being able to condemn someone. Now, that's the adulterous woman. That is when Jesus has the adulterous woman. They bring her before him and say, this woman was just caught in adultery. And Jesus says, ye without sin cast the first stone. And they all leave because they're not supposed to be condemning this woman to death. That is for the Lord to decide and judge. However, Jesus says, I don't condemn you. Go and sin no more. And that's the part. Go and sin no more. When a sin is called out, or when somebody who should know better but doesn't is corrected, it's saying, hey, this is what's going on. It shouldn't be anymore. Now, you know, here's what the Bible says. You know, please don't do it anymore. I'm not calling out this person. I'm not saying what ministry they're part of. I'm not even saying what band is on that t-shirt. That is not my intent. My intent is to use real life examples and talk to my fellow believers, people who are very serious about their walks with the Lord, or very serious about their leadership, because it says clearly in the Bible that leaders will be judged harshly. And if you cause the young ones in Christ to stumble, you're in trouble. It says so, Matthew 18, 6 through 7. So because I'm in this position as a watchman, as somebody who cares about the sheep, as someone who cares about my brothers and sisters in Christ who are or yet are to be, that's why I do this. I do this because I love you guys, I love the leaders. I love the people in the congregation. I love the little, the children, the baby new believers, or people that don't even know Jesus yet, who haven't been saved and set free yet. 1 Corinthians 5 talks about how as Christians we're supposed to judge sin so that it is not continued and thought of as being okay in other places. And Deborah is a judge that is appointed by God in the Bible. We are not supposed to be hypocritical judges, but we are supposed to judge in love biblically, because otherwise we're just a tolerant, progressive, liberal society that will not stand up and say, hey, wait a second, that's not what the Bible says. That'll get you put in hell. And then everybody's going to hell because they don't know what the Bible says. They don't know what God says is going to end up condemning them to eternal fire. Satan wants us to think that hell is no big deal. Satan wants us to think that our decisions here on earth will have no consequence later. Hell is very real. Jesus is very real, and he's coming soon. I don't want this to be taken in offense. There were people that were saying, well, God looks at the heart. And you're absolutely right. God does look at the heart. But there are people that are looking at that guy's physical appearance, not at his heart. And if your heart is pure, Matthew 5 says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Is your heart pure? How can it be if what you listen to, what you watch, what you read is all about things that Jesus was nailed to the cross for because they're so sinful and cause you to go to hell? Today's Christmas Eve. Jesus died for my sins. Jesus died for your sins. Jesus died for our mistakes. We should be purifying ourselves. We should be showing him that we love him in all facets of our life. The music, the media, the things that come out of our mouth, the things that we meditate on. The way we treat our families, the music we listen to, the movies we watch, the books that we read, all of those things should show the Lord that our hearts and minds and souls are on him and that we are grateful for his sacrifice. There's that story in the Bible about the guy who gets forgiven much debt and then the guy that gets forgiven just a little bit of debt. And Jesus says, which one do you think was more grateful? And of course, it's the person who's been forgiven much. And I have been forgiven so much. If you guys had known me before Jesus, I was very wicked. I was just awful and lost and leading others astray and thinking that I was going to heaven when I absolutely wasn't. And now that I know better, now that I read the Bible, now that I spend time with God every day, I know better, and I want you guys to know better too. I've cut all of that stuff out of my life, out of gratitude, out of love, out of adoration and respect and a desire to be pure in heart so that I will see God and so that God will see that I love him with all my heart, mind, soul, and strength. That's what he wants from us. And so, I just want you to think, Why did God come to earth? Why was Jesus born? He humbled himself and he sacrificed himself so that we wouldn't be drawn to things like drugs and promiscuous sex and music that glorifies evil, so that we would be free and be taught to rid ourselves of these things. I'm gonna play, it's called We Are the Shepherds by Johnny Cash, just to lighten this up a little bit. I love Johnny Cash, and he was a man a lot like me. He started out with secular music in drugs and promiscuity and smoking and drinking and living a very sinful, very bondaged lifestyle that he couldn't get out of. And then he met Jesus. And he spent the rest of his life loving his wife, not using drugs ever again, and using his gifts for God's glory. And that's how I want to be. My favorite pastor that I personally know, Pastor Johnny, did the same thing. He was this guy that I met very early on in my Christian walk, my surrender to Jesus, who loved God, and he made it look cool, and he made it real. And because of people like that who set themselves apart, who really love the Lord their God with all their heart, mind, soul, and strength, besides the freedom in Jesus, that's why I'm here today. And I hope I'm that for somebody, because Jesus is all that matters. All of this world is going to pass away. The world is on its way out right now. The Bible says that it's going to grow old and wear out like a garment. And it's not sustainable much longer. We might go to war. We don't know what tomorrow brings, but I have peace. And I want others to have the peace that I have. And it's because I don't allow the pollution of the world and the lies and the deception and the evil in my heart, mind, and soul anymore, that I can sit here while everything falls apart and praise the Lord. So here's We Are the Shepherds by Johnny Cash.
Is the stable, and there is the manger, the new Savior sleeps on his first earthly night. The wise men brought riches, but we brought a candle. It's all that we have, but it gives a good light. Our flocks when the near
the shepherds talk about all they had was a candle to offer the Lord. And there's a book called The Spiritual Man by Watchman Nee, N-E-E. And he talks about how the man's soul, body, and spirit are one. And he compares it to a light bulb. And he says that the body is like the bulb, the soul is like the wire, and the electricity is what lights the bulb, and the spirit of a man is what makes the light. Now, if your spirit is being filled, if your soul is being filled with things of the world, you're more like a black light. It's a little bit light, but it's not the pure, bright, warm, inviting light of God that you're going to want to have and to bless others with as a Christian. Matthew 5:14 says, "You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." And the only reason that I have any good works going on in my life is because Jesus is King of my heart. And that is why I do this, because I want you guys to know what He's shown me. And the only reason that I know is because I'm always, always, always reading my Bible and always checking what I'm thinking and saying and doing and reading against the pure, true Word of God. And if you want to shine bright for Him, you've got to take away all the things that block out your light, like things of the world. Every little thing of the world that you put into your spirit will darken it. And you want to have that pure light that only comes from following Jesus. So God bless you guys. Merry Christmas. And I submit that you show the Lord how much you love Him by giving Him the gift of a purer heart this year. God bless you.